to be nominated in a category by some of your toughest critics, your peers. It should be a milestone achievement for anyone from newbies to seasoned pros. So I hope that filmmakers see value in both the community that's growing and also a sense of verification that people really appreciate their hard work, their early mornings, you know, to get that shot.
You're listening to the Drone Radio Show podcast, the show about drones and the people who use them for business, fun, and research. Hosted by Randy Goers.
Hello, everyone. This is Randy Goers, and welcome to the Drone Radio Show podcast, episode 312. Are you ready for the Boston Drone Film Festival? Stay tuned, because today we're going to learn all we need to know to enjoy this up-and-coming event scheduled for March 19th and 20th. My guests today are Jovan Tanisevic and Jamie Wiener of the Boston Drone Film Festival. Jovan is founder of the festival and director at Above Summit, a production studio specializing in drone cinematography. Jamie is the festival director. The Boston Drone Film Festival celebrates the creative pursuit of international drone cinematography and drone photographers from around the world. Serving as a platform for talented drone content creators, the Boston Drone Film Festival hopes to inspire a new generation to push the limits of what's creatively possible with the technology. In this edition of the Drone Radio Show, Jovan and Jamie talk about the history of the Boston Drone Film Festival. They'll talk about this year's schedule and how we can attend and participate in the virtual event. But before we hear from Jamie and Jovan, I want to thank those of you who are supporting my funding campaign. Whether it's a dollar, $100, or much more, you can help defray the cost of production and keep the podcast going and growing. Go to droneradioshow.com/donate. So let's learn about the Boston Drone Film Festival with Jamie Wiener and Jovan Tanisevic. Let's pick up the interview where I ask Jovan and Jamie to introduce themselves.
My name is Jamie Wiener. I am this year's festival director. So basically, if you've had any contact with anyone concerning the festival, you've probably spoken to me many emails back and forth. But yeah, I've been organizing everything this year, from just what's happening in Drone Camp to what's going on with the nominations and the videos submitted.
I'm Jovan Tanisevic, the festival's founder. My team and my background is in drone cinematography under Above Summit, which is our production studio. And we put this thing together in 2019 for the first go, and are very grateful for the work that Julia Curiali, who was the previous festival director, did to bring that all together the first year, and what Jamie has really, you know, I think navigated the COVID landscape with this year.
Yeah. Big shout out to Julia.
Yeah, Jamie and Julia really, I think, pulled a lot of hours to make this happen over the years. Jamie, you know, having picked up a lot of this stuff over this last year. Without her, there's really no festival, so we can't thank her enough.
In a nutshell, how would you describe the Boston Drone Film Festival?
The Boston Drone Film Festival celebrates the creative pursuit of top drone cinematographers and drone photographers from around the world. That said, I mean, really, the Boston Drone Film Festival is a place for people to get together and get to know each other. Like the 2019 festival really felt great to meet new faces in the industry, to hear from them. And I say that from a learning perspective on my end, because I learned a great deal from everyone that chose to volunteer their time, both in the panels and the workshops and all the great entries into the festival, which is really kind of the crux of the premiere, the two-day event. The premiere is the first day, and that's where you'll see a lot of these great nominees from around the world. So the Boston Drone Film Festival is a platform for both education and also, you know, really celebrating these
achievements.
Yeah, both technologically and the numerous talent out there that are pushing the boundaries of this technology.
How long has it been around?
So we had our first festival in 2019, which was super successful. And then with COVID, 2020 kind of took a back seat. We had planned it for certain dates, and then just with everything going on in the world and us kind of reassessing it now being virtual, we took kind of a backseat for 2020 and now we're just going full force into 2021. So technically this is our second year, but a year kind of was in the middle just because of, you know, the world, world crisis. So
yeah.
How did you stimulate interest in this year's show considering the pandemic?
You know, I think we just kind of took a direction where we really tried to see what people were ingesting. And that's kind of a lot of more social media content. So I think we kind of went the extra mile on our social media campaign this year, just knowing that there's more eyeballs there right now because people are home and people are looking at their screens. So I think we really kind of took advantage of that. And that's how we got a lot of new creators to submit this year, which has been really fantastic. Instagram, especially just having that be a visual medium was a really, really useful tool for us to kind of find more submitters and just kind of get to
spread the word.
Yeah, get a community going.
And I think you are seeing a lot of new talent coming out and trying to find a platform to show their work on, to validate it with their peers. And it's shown based on the submissions from all around the world, like the furthest corners of the world. So it's great that we're seeing a more maturing kind of range of entries from around the world and a lot of repeats from last year or the previous year. I think that saw value in what we do as an organization, as a community, and wanted to, you know, re-enter this year, whether they
after won learning last. More too. Yeah. I feel like you can see that people's talent really what they've used this time and really honed in on their talent and they really want to showcase it. And that's what we love about people that come back every year is seeing their progress. And hopefully we had a part in that in any way, but that's what's really rewarding.
How many entries did you receive?
Just around 600, which you know grew from last time around as we got more word out. You know, I think it was hard to thin that down based on qualifications. I think there was most people followed the qualification requirements of 50% drone or more. And, you know, our jurors had a tough time, I think, between certain submissions to really to do their jobs.
Yeah.
So it was a good, I think, turnout for us. We didn't know how it was going to turn out because initially it was a slow start. We didn't really know when our date was. We switched it kind of late because we really wanted to put together an online platform that's going to be, you know, a little bit more work on our end in pre-production, essentially, instead of having an event. So we wanted to give it time
to be really solid.
It's a good, solid experience for everyone. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think it gave us also more room to bring in more interest this time.
How did you narrow that many submissions down to the final selections?
I think we have to hand it to the jurors. I mean, we handpicked these jury members based on their careers and the knowledge they have and certain expertise in their career. And I think each juror brought different things to the table, which was really awesome because obviously we have about 14 categories and those span many different types of drone content. So we really relied on our jurors and their experience to kind of give us advice on this would go good here, this may be good better in a different category, and just this has really great content and you need to give it the praise it deserves.
Yeah, I think the jury had, you know, their rounds of review and comment and, you know, based on how we paired each juror to the various categories that they were responsible for, based on their experience, even matching them to some categories that they might not have been as familiar with. I think that's good to have different angles, but oftentimes trying to pair them with what they're most experienced with in categories. The jury being a wide range kind of helped us decide which categories for each person. So I think that was kind of our dances to find the right jury to spread the weight.
How did you match up the jurors to the films they reviewed?
Each juror's background, we kind of felt, where could you give the best input into what we're having you judge? And then...
Yeah, so they would kind of judge based on like a grouping of categories.
Yeah.
So that, you know, they didn't get hit with seeing every single submission from every single category. I think it would be unrealistic for them to go through.
Yeah, I think it'd be a little overwhelming.
So I think they voted for specific categories, and then the grand prize winner was kind of based off of their all of their comments and the amount of votes that they gave for each of the category winners and how they broke overall.
You know, actually, one of my good friends, Nicole Abbott from Tampa, is a juror for this year's show. And she said it was a great experience and loved getting behind the scenes and screening the films.
Yeah, she's quite the dynamic duo of being nice person and having talent.
Yeah, I met her at the first go at the show in November of 2019, and she was awesome. That's the thing we're going to miss this year. Yeah, it's going to be virtual, but I think those connections are, you can't replace them. And then this is why she's continued that relationship with our community. So I think it was invaluable to meet people in person, get to know them in person. So hopefully we'll get back on face-to-face by next go.
What was the most popular category in terms of the number of entries?
I think landscape and showreel were really popular this year. I just feel like they had a lot. There was a lot of content to go through it there. And I think that kind of makes sense to me, coming from someone who doesn't have as extensive a drone background and career. I think when you first think of drones, to me, I think of like wide landscape shots, just for me personally. So I think there is just like a lot of interest in general to those categories. And then showreel is just showing what you got, showing everything and making it cohesive. So
a lot of people wanted to show that the showreel off. You definitely could see the popularity in that particular format. I think there was a lot of FPV that has now kind of matured as its own style of filming with drones, and it made its way into various categories, not just the ones that are specific to FPV. So we saw a change in that as well that went well to landscapes and sometimes even in documentary. Some of the submissions mixed different types of drones, which is really good to see that they have more of a range in their experience as filmmakers with drones. But yeah, definitely saw a lot of, and I think last year was similar in some ways, a lot of interest in showreel, landscape. You know, I think it's easier to format something where it's a short form cut with at least 50% of drone in those categories.
Which category do you think most challenges the filmmaker?
For me personally, seeing these submissions, I think documentary and narrative, the definition of documentary obviously is challenging to find a lot of submissions that just focus in that format. So I think it's more of a documentary narrative. We're learning also from how submissions kind of came in this year, how we might change next year's go and focus things a little bit more. But documentary narrative challenges on all fronts. I think it's important to show that drone is your creative outlet. You have a really good sense for how to use it properly. But with that format, it challenges you to also think about narrative, voice, and groundwork. And I'm not saying that I think the judges emphasized one submission over another because it showed more skill and groundwork or something like that. But I think as an overall category and the challenges around that, documentary, I think for me, pushes all the right experience levels that we want to see candidates showing. And I think with that also, you could potentially talk about film editing. And, you know, there's a lot of great talent in filming, capturing drone work, but color grading, pacing, transitions, just the way that you tell a short narrative or an adrenaline pumping cut through film editing is important for someone in my background, where I really kind of look to see their techniques in that sense, shows more maturity and through, you know, the range of different aspects of production, from conceiving it, shooting it, and editing it. And I think those two categories, you know, some of the jurors really enjoyed seeing those and evaluating based on those criteria.
As did I.
Let's talk about this year's event. What can we expect when we tune in?
With everything being virtual, we kind of separated the festival into two different days. So day one is going to be our film screening, our award show. That's when you find out who's won the grand prize trip to Ecuador this year. So that's going to be all live, and we'll have all that information on our website. And then day two focuses on kind of the education background of this. Is we want to start and open a conversation about certain topics that, whether you're new to drones or you've been going and doing drone work for years, we want to bring a worthy conversation where we can bring people together and create a community and educate ourselves and inspire other people. And I think, so we have a bunch of workshops and we have panels and we have a demonstration. And I mean, March 20th is going to be a day full of just so much content, and that will be available after the festival as well for you to just kind of get your, either jump right in or get your feet wet with drone information.
This year's festival is similar to the format we had in our first year, where, you know, the premiere is just this all-inclusive, showing and celebrating the winners, where everyone can come and watch it now free because there's no venue, it's online. So that particular part will be free to everyone to click on the link on the website and watch as we do announce all of the winners in each category and the grand prize winner. And that'll hype for, I think, what is for me the most valuable aspect, which is the community aspect that follows the next day, as Jamie mentioned, full of workshops, panels, and demo. It's what we spent a lot of time on curating for the community to, you know, get value out of. And there's going to be a general chat where, you know, everyone's in a lounge. We learned through COVID how to try to, you know, make this effective virtually. So we're going to have a general pool for everyone to kind of chat when they're not going into a specific workshop or watching a panel. The schedule is basically, you know, starting with a demo in the morning, leading to,
I mean, it's workshops on top of workshops, and then panels. We have panels spread out through the day, and they all have such a range of different topics that touch upon. So no matter what kind of interest you have in drones, I do feel like there's something there that you would find interesting.
What are some of the topics that you'll be covering on Saturday?
First thing that we're going to open up with is an immersive VR experience, a demonstration by
our partner
SGO Mystica, which is one of our partners. They are specialists in 360 editing software. So I think it's a great learning experience for newcomers and something that will kick off the workshops. And then Nicole Abbott will be presenting drones for business, building your business from ground up. I think that a lot of our community that we've seen that's engaging this, that's also submitting, is a newcomer and is very brave to submit, you know, their work to really push their boundaries. And I think learning how to formalize their business is a big part of it. So that's a hugely valuable, I think, lesson from Nicole. There's going to be specialists in FPV that are going to talk about things. A really good discussion on women in drones, obviously, is Karen Murphy, a longtime member of the community of drone filmmakers. Susan K. Smith and Nicole Abbott, again, is going to make an appearance with Loretta Alcalay, who's a repeat from last year. She really enjoyed her experience on our panel last year, and Kim Players as well. Drones and video production with our friend Martin Sloops from the Netherlands. He's someone that I've admired over the years with his technique and filmmaking. And I think he's going to have a really good sense and perspective for people that are looking to take it to that next level of production work, or people that are already in it and want to hear from someone in their field. Great information from locals like Greg Sager, who is well known in not just the local area. He's got a great IG following, and he's going to talk about his process. He really takes the time to plan his shots, and you can tell from how he curates his work, kinds of shots he does share, and how, you know, he really works to curate that look and capture that, because you only have one chance. But if you spend a lot of time planning, I think that's critical to his success. And then from last year, Chris Teal, you know, aka Westside FPV, and learning editing from him firsthand is going to be awesome. I can't wait for that, particularly to watch that one. And then Noel Thomas, he's local to New York. He was a submitter last year. We got to meet him. And again, excellent at hyperlapse and time lapse. He really specializes in that. If anyone knows it, it's him. Mike Bishop, he's going to be talking about VFX to drone footage, which again helps people to really bring their experience level in post-production, if they're newcomers, to the next level. Then we have FPV drone racing with Mako Reacta, who is a big part of the drone community. She's obviously at the top of her game. And then our personal friend Dan Wall, who's a local in the New England area. He has a unique style and a sensitivity to different types of builds. So learning from someone who understands how each build can achieve a specific look, feel for FPV, and why each one has its own look and feel. And then from last year and back this year for another round, Andy LeClerc and Jamie Malcolm Brown, a lot of people already know their names in the industry because they've been kind of out there and sharing their process. And I can't wait to see what they put together for our workshops. We have some repeat from last year with Ian Kerr from the Snotbot and, a lot of newcomers, Solly Levy, Gustavo Lozada, Daniel DeLeon, and Debbie Saunders. They're all going to give us a really interesting look at how to be sensitive around wildlife and how to properly use drones with a respect to wildlife. And then back to 360 to round things off at the tail end of the day before we get some drinks and really chat with everyone is editing aerial 360 video with the legend Hugh Ho. He's obviously the foremost experience in 360 and drone work specific with 360. So Hugh, we're honored to have him as part of the festival. And then Vic Moss, Vic Moss is such an important figure for the drone industry in terms of responsible use of drones and really understanding the formalities that some people really get lost in. I think if anyone knows that topic best, it's Vic. And then finally, at the tail end of the day, we're going to have the talk with a bunch of panelists like Paul Nurkula, Joshua Bardwell, Virgin from last year is going to be a part of that, and Dan Wall. All have various experience in FPV. This is talking about the future of FPV because I think, the future of something every year changes. We always have these assumptions and then something, with the technology accelerates or changes. So hearing from them on how they see FPV, which is a very rapidly changing part of industry, will be very interesting.
For those that aren't familiar with first-person view, how does a film shot with FPV differ from one that isn't?
Flying FPV and visualizing those shots, they already know how the look and feel of the GoPro is going to be. So really, I think the barrier was the feed that they're getting, and it's only improved over the years. So they're able to anticipate how it's going to look, how they can shape that shot. I think it's the most freeform tool at our disposal right now in terms of really kind of creating dynamic shots, doing things that were never before possible before even drones. Some of these shots before even a drone was around were impossible. But now, like with FPV drones, really some of these extremely quick changes in direction and
tight corners.
Threading needles, the limitations are opening up for what even a drone can do now more and more.
So maybe a little better camera control and a different field of view?
The FOV is important. Obviously, I'm not an FPV pilot, but a lot of FPV pilots that I've spoken to, I think they have different preferences for lenses, camera FOVs that they've used. And they always fly with that sense in mind, like that they're framing something for cinematic use, or if they're, doing drift chases and stuff like that. It's sometimes, hard to perfectly frame something, but I think a talented FPV pilot and a lot of the entries that we've seen anticipate how it's going to look cinematically and fly with their goggles, with that in mind.
Other than the fact that people would be in one place, would this year's show be organized differently if it was a live event?
I think the schedule kind of honestly would have looked the same. Even when we're in year one, it was definitely a lot of back-to-back things and always having content going. So I think this year it might be even a little bit easier to kind of navigate because you're just clicking instead of running from one place to the next. It's our goal always is to jam-pack as much content as possible, especially since you can access it after the event. So we just want to create as many conversations as possible. So yeah, we probably would have around the same amount.
If you are attending, you have access to that for a year's span since from the event on, so that if you want to revisit or you don't have to pick and choose necessarily which workshop you go to at 2 p.m. because there's only, there's two options. You can go to the other one after the fact. It will obviously have a start time, but this time around, the content will already be up there. I think as a small team, it's easier for us to, make that available after the event's over. Now that, it's kind of out there, it's already pre cued. And I think people will find that slightly different and more valuable maybe. But in next year, if we have it in person, I think we're going to still have a similar format to what the drone camp has been. We're just going to probably try to pack more options in there and figure out ways to bring it to a broader online community like we have already.
So the big question is, how can people attend the event?
So we're going to be posting all this information on our page, but you can buy tickets through Festivee and all the content will be on Festivee, which we'll link in the bottom of this podcast. Yeah, so you'll have access to that and that's where everything will be. We'll have it live embedded videos. We have pre-recorded things as well. So all of our content will be linked there and your ticket will give you the link to that as well.
There's really two portals, bostondronefilmfestival.com or BOSDFF. BOSDFF.com or going to our Festivee page, either through our website or directly from Festivee, festivee.com/ what's BOSDFF. So festivee.com/BOSDFF should bring you to our event page.
One of the objectives of the Boston Drone Film Festival is to promote creativity using drones. Is that happening in this year's films?
Yeah, we're seeing a lot of incredible footage. You know, this seemingly impossible single takes are always really a wow factor. Even for seasoned jurors, it seemed like they got a lot of great response. You know, I think the tool's been refined, and I think it's the entry point for it is more accessible. So there's more people experimenting with it, pushing its boundaries. And that's great to see the range of experience, the range of styles growing. I think it's maturing as a tool. So you're seeing people finding even more extremes to get that new wow factor. It's definitely breaking ground in that sense, breaking ground with what's possible on an FPV drone. For example, like I said, there's a lot of heavy lift flying better cameras, but ultimately, you know, it's how it's being flown. And I think people are getting more experience and maturing that area too.
And I think people also rise to the occasion of the festival. I've had been talking with a lot of content creators that have submitted that said that they specifically went out to film something because they wanted to submit it to the festival. So I think just having the festival in and of itself already makes filmmakers try to push their boundaries a little bit to stand out, which is really incredible to watch.
Do you think that drone films are just part of an overall movie making process? Or are they a unique art form to themselves?
That's a great question. And I think it's both. Aerial work's been around for ages and it's proven its worth for establishing shots, critical for the groundwork, the meat and potatoes of movie filmmaking. But that said, drones are expanding what aerial cinematography in movies can do. They can redefine or replace certain types of camera work, whether it's jibs, dollies, you know, a lot of the work that has been cumbersome sometimes to maybe not do a shot. Well, you know, I think they're freeing up filmmakers both for budgetary or just time constraints to try to do different things. So I think they're increasing their role on sets in a production realm. But to the other side of it, I think drones can be standalone, as we see, you know, by the nominees in every single one of our categories. They can be a standalone tool. I like to see the well-rounded aspect of filmmakers' entry, their submissions, but I think drones really can conceptually redefine how a story is told, how it's edited, and stand their ground.
What does having a submission in the Boston Drone Film Festival mean to a filmmaker?
I think we're trying to create this community, and I think the festival is a tool for that. But really what we want out of the festival is just to bring people together. I think we want to see people pushing each other, inspiring each other, and creating partnerships and collaborations. And I think that's what's so great about the festival and why we obviously do the drone camp too, is it just starts these conversations and these relationships that just make so much amazing in content that can start with one conversation. Like we previously were talking about meeting Nicole Abbott the first year of the festival. And now we have a really awesome relationship with her and she's coming back and she's doing a workshop. So even just in the most basic sense of getting to know someone and networking, I think this festival is creating a community that can really rely on each other and create something really amazing.
Yeah, I think to be a filmmaker attending this festival is, you know, I think as our community grows and helps to raise some of these upcoming talent and new talent, I think also to be nominated in a category by some of your toughest critics, your peers, it should be a milestone achievement for anyone from newbies to seasoned pros. So I hope that filmmakers see value in both a community that's growing and also a sense of verification that people really appreciate their hard work, their early mornings, you know, to get that shot.
Yeah, I think if anything, we know what it takes to get the shots that these people are creating. So I think there's that level of appreciation. Like you said, like, yeah, you got up at 6 a.m. for that shot. And I know you did.
4 a.m. on Somerset.
Exactly. So I think that there's that kind of camaraderie and respect that when you're critiqued by people that are your peers, it's a different level of appreciation, we think.
What do you think makes a film worthy of consideration?
There's so much at play. I think each category has different ideas. I think what I would say a lot of jurors look at is originality, consistency in style and technique. And that goes not just for flying, but editing, as Jovan was saying before, a lot can be lost or won solely on the strength of an edit. So you really have to consider that. That's when you know you've got a creative piece that is worthy of the festival, is when it really meets those criteria and just takes it to above and beyond sometimes too.
Can you give us an idea of the logistics and the planning that goes into an event like this, regardless if it's virtual or live?
It is a lot to undertake as a small team. You know,
it was a new challenge for sure.
And then Jamie came into it with a steep learning curve, but you know, I think amazing work for the short period of time that you had to kind of navigate not only managing the festival and coordinating all these different people, but I think in the realm of COVID, you know, I think it was rethinking how are we going to connect with our audience and the filmmakers properly? How can we
trusting
make it easy
each other.
For, yeah.
Yeah. I think we had a lot of trust in each other to have a certain vision, and knowing that whether we're working together independently, that we can execute it in the way that we both really want. And I think that's how our separate voices come together and can really work in harmony. And I think you can see that throughout the festival, that it has a distinct voice. And although we had a team of people working on it, we really came together and we realized how important it was to have this festival, and that regardless of the COVID situation, that we wanted to make this happen. It was important. And it's not going to stop it just because we can't meet in person. So I think it was a big deal to us to, even despite what's going on in the world, that this needs to happen. People need it.
It's a labor of love, let me say, from like a founding sponsor's perspective and the resources that it takes as a small productions team to curate some of this stuff. Because again, we have to do a lot of the cutting of the sizzles for each category and a lot of the logistics behind that. It does take a lot of work from our day to day. And it's a labor of love. I think it's because we had a great turnout last time, great experience. I think it's worth it. It's worth undertaking it more and seeing where it can go for a platform for other people to celebrate their achievements. And I think we clearly see a value in doing it again. So
going back before the first Boston Drone Film Festival, where did the idea come from?
The initial stages of Boston Drone Film Festival really came out of our experience at a similar format. And we loved being at New York in their first year, New York Drone Film Festival being the first, I think, successful format for this. And there have been others over the years. I think it really made us see how exciting it can be to do this. We have a great local community of drone operators and cinematographers and all of that, that I thought, you know, would benefit from that. A lot of our friends voiced that it would be great to do. We iced it for quite a while, I'd say, nearly 5 years before we decided, you know, maybe this is the right year for it. By then, I think the format for us really kind of came to, because we got to know a lot of people over those 5 years in a growing community that hadn't necessarily formalized in the initial stages of the idea of doing this festival here for Boston's community, but internationally as well, that helped us put it together, that really made us feel like, okay, we can confidently get a good body of jurors that's going to really legitimize the festival's nominations and the process behind that, because that's important. But we also were able to have a great response from people that like Nicole Abbott, like Kara Murphy, and all of the people like that are local, like Andy LeClerc and Jamie Malcolm Brown that I mentioned, and the range of other people from around that we got to meet through this that volunteered their time and said, you know, I want to give back to that community too and be part of this first go. They trusted us to run it, to put it together, and we didn't take that responsibility lightly. And I think the initial stages to now, it's grown. We've learned a lot from last go and are applying it to this experience now online. We have really exciting things that I think after even this year, we can't wait to put together for next year that might really help bring, you know, more value to the community.
Are you both filmmakers?
I am not. So I have more background in like event planning and things of that such. So I think that's why Jovan brought me on the team. But it's been so incredibly insightful to see this community in such a different way than what I'd previously thought, and just see the talent and the artistry. So I think for me, coming from that background has really opened my eyes to how beautiful drone filmmaking really is. Obviously, Jovan has more history, but I think for me as a newcomer, I just loved going through all the submissions and seeing how the different categories translated to drone and how people had such different ideas and different takes on things. And I think for me as a creative person, I was just so inspired by that. So yeah, I don't have the background, but honestly, I've looked into learning how to do FPV because I thought it was super interesting. And so we'll see, but maybe in the future, you'll be hearing about me on the scene.
Yeah, I think it was great to see Jamie's perspective because it was from an outside perspective, obviously beneficial for us in her experience prior to this to help run the mechanics of a festival, which, you know, there's a lot to do ahead of time to make it all run smoothly so everyone enjoys it. And I think it was great to see her learning about the community through it. And I kind of had an experience in it as a first-time filmmaker coming into the beginnings of drone in the 2013 timeframe, 2012, 2013, when it was still very new to everyone. I think seeing that community grow, you know, it's kind of a full circle for me to see it now, to be able to run this festival and give back to that community and help it continue to legitimize itself and learn from one another.
Jovan, from your perspective as founder of the festival and your involvement over the past 3 years, has it impacted your own filmmaking?
You know, I think it definitely has given me the time that I don't usually have to watch others, to learn from others. I don't usually get to spend so much time learning about what's, you know, what's hot out there. I sometimes see it, of course, but like, I think it's definitely helped me to understand what is strong about certain types of shots, the full range of techniques out there and how they use them creatively. You know, I think it really gives me an appreciation for the amount of work involved in some of this, whether it's a smooth hyperlapse. Like, you know, I think Noel does it better than anyone, I think. And learning that from him definitely has improved our own technique and, you know, learning how to do color grading and stuff like that has helped our video editors and how we set up for shots. You know, I think from other people, both submissions as well as the workshoppers, definitely has given us another baseline to look and judge our own work.
What does the future hold for the Boston Drone Film Festival?
I think my goal is for us to only get bigger. That's my personal goal. I see Boston Drone Film Festival. I think, you know, right now we have it as a 2-day festival, but I'm ready for it to be a week-long festival full of different.
I don't know if I'm ready for that.
I think there's just so much different type of content that we can give a voice to, whether it's an in-person would be great of like FEV drone racing, if we could do like a drone racing thing. So I think we're always trying to push and innovate and kind of listen to our community, see what it has to say, and then see how we can incorporate their different insights into how we can kind of give them a voice. So I think we're always listening to our community, and I think it will always be adapting. And hopefully for me, it will only get bigger.
future proofing. But no, I think it's been great to see how everyone's responded to the previous year. I can't wait to see what they say about their experience this year. And we already have some ideas for how to give different options for people looking to submit that might not, you know, find the right type of category or format for themselves. So we're responding to that as well. But, you know, as a film festival, I think next year we're going to try to obviously give more strength to that as a, you know, I think a 2-day event. I think it gives a sense for both the film aspects on the one day and the resources for filmmakers on the second day. But I think the film festival part, the first day, definitely next year, I think if it's in person, we're going to see a little bit of a refinement on that. And we're going to see categories that I think bring it to that level of production film and give that more voice, that the second day might not necessarily expand on that into more of the general uses of drones, which I think, like, you know, Jamie mentioned, there's more opportunity to do that with people.
It's also one of those things of when they're constantly innovating, there's always new things that we want to explore. And that's why we always reassess our categories every year. We want to make sure that we're seeing people from all different corners of drone filmmaking. And so we always try to adapt and listen to this community. And that's how we'll always operate the festival, is listening to people, taking their feedback, and really trying to give a voice.
This is a little bit off topic, but I think, you know, the format for the festival having a grand prize each year of a travel, where, you know, last year as a production crew following Virgin, who is an extremely talented FPV pilot, we learned so much from him on that. So I look forward to the trip with the grand prize winner to Ecuador, hopefully, you know, with COVID restrictions aside. That type of a journey we try to, I think, repeat every year, because we're learning from the grand prize winner as we trail them on this and give them a platform to learn in a different environment or experiment with their tools that they're used to, as well as things that they're not familiar with that broaden their experience as a filmmaker. So for me, the grand prize trip, wherever it is, I think is an exciting part and kind of a cherry on top for the hard work put into making this festival and for the grand prize winner themselves.
Especially during the winter time, right?
Yeah, you want to go south.
And for my final question, what message would you like to leave regarding this year's Boston Drone Film Festival?
I think just one of the biggest takeaways that we have is just, if you have any interest getting involved in drones, then take the plunge. This community has countless resources and opportunities to aid you if you're a beginner. And you never know when a hobby might turn into a career. We've seen that story with a lot of our submitters and a lot of the people on our jury and stuff like that. So
myself just, personally.
Yeah. Exactly. And then just to close it out, we're just going to say, be sure to check out the festival. March 19th is the film screening and award show, and we're doing that for free this year. So be sure to check our page out for that and our Instagram as well. And don't forget to grab your all-access pass to Drone Camp for only $50. And that gives you access to all the workshops, panels, and demos on the 20th. So be sure to check it out, and thanks for having us.
That's it for episode 312 of the Drone Radio Show. I hope you enjoyed hearing from Jovan Tanisevic and Jamie Wiener of the Boston Drone Film Festival. I want to thank Jovan and Jamie for taking the time to speak with me. If you want to learn more about the Boston Drone Film Festival and how to attend the event, check out the website at bostondronefilmfestival.com. Remember, this year's event is virtual and scheduled for March 19th and March 20th. If you like the Drone Radio Show, please consider supporting the podcast with a small donation. The content is always free, but for as little as $1, you can help defray the cost of production. To donate, go to droneradioshow.com/donate. And thanks for listening. Your support means a lot to me. And I hope you'll listen to more episodes of the Drone Radio Show podcast to hear how others are using drones for business, fun, and research. For the Drone Radio Show, I'm Randy Goers.
This has been the Drone Radio Show podcast. More information on today's show can be found on our website at www.droneradioshow.com. If you're using drone technology for business, fun, or research and would like to share your experience on the show, please visit our website and fill out a guest appearance application. And don't forget to follow us on your favorite social media channels.